lived under the Nazi regime from 1933 to 1939 was the only Jewish student in a school of Hitler Youth. In November 1938, he witnessed the destruction of his home and the arrest of his father, who was sent to a concentration camp in a cattle car. After escaping to England and later to America, he became a lawyer, and after all the fall of the Berlin Wall, returned to his East German hometown to reconcile with his ex-classmates and to become the town's only living honorary citizen. He was subsequently honored for his work on forgiveness and reconciliation, and his German citizenship was later restored. He has presented on the power of forgiveness workshops all over the United States and has written an autobiography called Survivor's Odyssey, which has been translated and is being used as a German text in German schools today. His story demonstrates that our past, no matter how painful, can help us to face our own shadows and to achieve compassion for the sufferings of others. Richard currently has another published book, which can be also purchased on Amazon or Barnes & Noble's, that's called The Sense of Time. For those interested in learning more, he'll be here later on.
So that's a poetry.
Talk to you a little bit
more.
It's a poetry book. He visits with us today from Washington, D.C. as an avid supporter of Legacy Leaders to share his experiences of that time. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Richard Winger. So, Richard, first of all, thank you for being with us. We're very honored to have you here today.
Yeah.
And obviously, as you know, many of the folks that you see here are our partners. They've somehow been involved with Legacy Leaders or have heard of us through just a series of different channels as we continue to do work in the city of Chicago. And we actually went and toured some of the schools earlier today.
Yes, that was wonderful.
Did you enjoy that?
Yeah, it was great.
So Richard, you got to actually see some of the places where we actually do our work. So we're so glad that you're here. I want to dive straight into this sort of session and talk a little bit about just sort of your experiences in around 1933 when you were in Germany. So I was wondering if you could maybe describe which your childhood was like before.
Yeah, I was born in 1927. That was 6 years before the Nazis came to power. And it was a small town, very famous town. It's a UN heritage site, actually, Wittenberg, the cradle of the Protestant Reformation. It's where Martin Luther famously posted his 95 theses against the existing church hierarchy on the door of the castle church and made history. That was, in fact, they're celebrating the 500th anniversary of that event next year. It was 1517. When that happened, Germany's actually, Wittenberg, my hometown, was actually founded in the 1200s, so it's very, very old. Until my first school day, my life was like that of any normal German child. I had my backyard gang of friends, we went hiking in the woods, I had a bike. It's a small town atmosphere and very comfortable, low key. My grandfather owned a small shoe factory, and my father and his brother Max ran it for him. And we used to chase around, my cousin Manfred and I used to chase around the shoe factory and make nuisances ourselves. And I had my best friend Wolfgang, who lived upstairs from same apartment house. So I was a normal, I thought I was a normal human child. My first school day, the very first school day, a guard was posted in front of my grandfather's shoe factory asking passersby not to buy from Jews. I was just under 6 years old, so I didn't know what that meant. It was kind of just didn't mean anything to me. But as time went by, the Nazis began issuing a bunch of so-called racial laws restricting the economic and social life of Jews, so that eventually we became more and more isolated from the rest of the town people. So that's basically what happened until the Nazis seized power.
Can I ask what changed after that?
Well, what changed was there were only two Jewish boys, actually, my cousin and I, in the town. It was a small town, 25,000 people. very few Jews. I think there were about 70 Jews, including everyone. We went to the elementary school, just the two of us were alone there as Jews. And even then, some of the kids were already getting propaganda from the Nazis, the anti-Semitic propaganda, and they didn't want to play with us. And when it turned to 4 years later, in German education, you can either choose to continue in elementary school and eventually learn a trade, or you can go to what they call middle school, which is like a commercial track, or you can go to gymnasium, which is the college track. And my father, of course, wanted me to go to gymnasium, and I did too. And by that time, they had a 1% quota for Jews. And I was it. I was the 1%. So my father went to see the principal in advance to see if he could guarantee my safety. Things had gotten so bad that that was a question. And he said, of course, no problem. And so I started to go there. And what happened in practice was, it was a very good curriculum, but what I dreaded most was recess in the schoolyard, because I was totally isolated. The other kids, nobody wanted to call, it's like in the old South, nobody wanted to call a nigger lover, well, nobody wanted to call a Jew lover. You know, so don't, even if they all felt differently themselves, it was just something you just didn't do, because the Nazis had put on such anti-Semitic propaganda that I was essentially alone, and they would throw pebbles at me, and some of the bully guys would yell things at me, you shouldn't even be here, who let you in, and you dirty Jew, you know. And I heard that every day at recess, so I really dreaded recess. That's what was happening. Meanwhile, there were other restrictions. For example, my mother's hairdresser, she went to a salon to have her hair done. You know, one day he said, Jews are no longer allowed to have hairdressed. So he said, I'd be willing to come to your house privately. And she said, I wouldn't have you do that, because you could be arrested for that. That's how bad things were. I was taking piano lessons. And one day the teacher said, sorry, no more music lessons for Jews. So one thing after another happened that restricted our lives. And I don't know what's going on back there, but something interesting.
Yeah. Trying to get a mic to him?
Yeah.
Can we do it without the stand? I just don't want that to cover his face in the video. Yeah, thank you.
Is that because I'm so pretty?
Yeah, that's it. That's it. They have to see your beautiful face.
So am I talking to this?
That'd be perfect.
Can you hear me? Okay. So anyway, where was I? I'm saying we felt the pressure, and that all came to a head on November 9th, 1938, which was the famous night of broken glass, called Kristallnacht in German, Crystal Night. And that was, it's generally considered to be the opening salvo of the Holocaust. So are we,
yeah,
question about that?
So I just wanted to ask this question. So as a young person, right, we work with a lot of young people who go through a lot of circumstances. They go through a lot of bullying. That's what it sounds like. It's like another version of bullying, if you will. What changed in you? Like, how did you feel about yourself while all of this was taking place? Can you address a little bit of that?
Well, does anybody here know the term internalized oppression? Internalized oppression is when you buy into what your persecutors are saying about you. So when you hear it every day, they're all saying it. You dirty Jew, Jews are like vermin, stuff like that. And my parents didn't insulate me against that. My father never said, no, that's not about you. And so bit by bit, my sense of self-esteem went down. And I felt I was less than. It was very, very hurtful emotionally. And that's why even today I can so identify when I hear anyone, any minority person, whether it be a black person or a woman or a transgender person, anybody put down, it immediately goes right. I feel that so intensely because I know exactly what that's like. When little kids on the street in Wittenberg would say a dirty Jew, a little four-year-old had learned that. Well, I am a Jew, it's true. Or no, the word was Jew, just Jude, not even dirty Jew, but just Jude. That was already the insult. And well, what could I say? Because I am a Jew. How do you answer that? And the whole population was gradually being influenced to echo that. And bit by bit, our social contacts grew less and less. People would avoid us more and more. Life went on, but mostly my parents had their few Jewish friends, and they didn't really associate much with non-Jews. They have people they played cards with every Wednesday night, other Jewish people. We had a half-Jewish dentist who had a place in outside town, a little country cottage, where the Jews on summer Sundays we were out there and just hang out and play ping pong. We had an air rifle. I mean, it was a little bit of life, but we were isolated. Insulated from the rest of society bit by bit. So,
thank you. I appreciate you sharing that. I know that some of our young people could identify with some of those experiences because as we work with, you know, youth here in the city of Chicago, you've heard all the stories about Chicago just from afar, and we're being characterized as this horrible city, right? Because there's so many things taking place. What I want to talk about, though, just getting back to your experience, was just your, you remember when we had talked, you had shared that you actually seen Adolf Hitler in person.
Yes. Oh, I got to tell you about that. I
was hoping you could describe
how many people can say that? I bet you nobody in this room. So, when the teacher walked into the classroom, we had to jump to our feet and click our heels, and all the other kids except me say, Heil Hitler. I mean, that was the greeting. On the street, if you ran into somebody, you didn't say good morning, good afternoon, you say, Heil Hitler. And if you didn't say it, people look funny at you. You're not with a program, you know, it's like that. So one day, we were taken down the railroad tracks because the Führer, it was called the Führer, the leader. That's what you are, right, the Führer?
I don't know if it's that kind of leader, though.
Well, if you were in Germany, you would be called the Führer.
At the time, yeah.
So, and because the Führer's train was going by, that's all. But then, another day, there was an explosion in a factory outside of town, and Hitler came to town to visit the hospital, and the teacher took us down to a downtown street corner, and the other kids all had their little paper swastika flags, and Hitler came by and standing in an open car, waving to the crowd like any politician. The little kids were just going crazy, Sieg Heil, Sieg Heil, Sieg Heil. They were yelling. And I looked at Hitler, and he was about as far away as you are. The car. I was on the sidewalk, and there he was. And I caught his eye just for a moment, and it was like mesmerizing. He had a hypnotic look that went right through me, and I could see the power he had almost to mesmerize the German people, because they thought of him as like a god. Anything the Führer wanted to do or did, and he made some very poor judgments, especially toward the end of the war, but nobody questioned him. And if you did, well, you might end up in, you know, concentration camp or something. You know, that was not okay in a dictatorship. If you've never lived in a dictatorship, has anybody here ever lived in a country or been in a country with a dictatorship? Maybe in South America, like Central America or something? Because you really learn to appreciate the United States when you've had that experience, because here you more or less free to talk and say what you want. I don't think it's 100% anymore, but at least it's 90%. A dictatorship, every house, every apartment house had a spy that would report on the comings and goings of the people. Every block had somebody like that. So there was so much surveillance. I mean, it makes ours look like, you know, kindergarten. It's you're always conscious of the fact that you, something wrong with
this feedback. Yeah, right there is great.
Okay. You're very, very conscious of what you what was safe to say and not to say. Don't say anything against the regime, but if you kept your mouth shut, no problem. I mean, if you weren't Jewish, but I mean, ordinary people, if you kept your mouth shut, and especially if you belong to the party, no problem, we're fine. And there was this myth that all the German people were solidly behind the Nazis, which I don't think is necessarily true. There were some people that really didn't, as things got worse, didn't like what's going on. And as things got worse and worse, we've come to the next question.
Well, you had talked about, and I read this in your bio as well, your father being arrested.
Yeah, okay, this is what happened. On the day of Crystal Night, it was November 9th,
that's what I wanted to
1938, the day that will live in my memory as the most traumatic night of my life. So they had religion class in school once a week, and I was excused from that. And we lived sort of across the down the block from the gymnasium that I went to school at. So they excused me to go home for lunch. And I get home and I see my mother at the kitchen table in tears. I say, "What's the matter, Mutti? Mutti?" It's like mom in German. "What's the matter, Mutti?" She said, "Your father's been arrested." I said, "Why?" She didn't know. So she was starting to heat up someone because he was still in the town jail at that point. She was heating some food up for him when two guys arrived from the utility company and said, "Sorry, we have orders to turn off your gas and electric." Well, that was a surprise. So they went ahead, and it was November, and so it got dark pretty early. And we were afraid to stay home alone. My aunt and her, you know, my uncle and cousin, and they lived just down the same block, about 100 yards down the block. So we decided to go over there. And we arrived, and everyone was sitting by candlelight because it was getting dark. Just two old grandparents, my aunt and my cousin and my mother and I. And we were like clueless. We didn't know what was going to happen next. It was scary. I mean, because we were, you know, they turned off our gas and electric, and my father was arrested. What was going to happen to us? And then this is one flight up with a bay window, and suddenly a rock came crashing through the bay window. And I sort of, we looked down, and the street was black with people yelling up, "You dirty Jews, your hour struck, and we're going to get you now." And there were some flickering torches, and just a rabble down there. Hundreds of people, they had all been, I mean, these are people that we used to know, that were used to ordinary neighbors, and now they had all been energized into this hatred against Jews. Next thing, the doorbell rang. And it was a man from the Gestapo, from the secret police, to search the apartment for weapons. Well, it's not like America. We didn't have a Second Amendment in Germany, so most people didn't have weapons. But he went from room to room, you know, looking, slashing some of the mattresses, and, you know, just looking everywhere. Of course, he didn't find anything. By the time he was finished, they were banging on the door already. And I remember my mother said, "Please don't open the door." And he said, "I'm through here." And he opened the door. About a dozen young guys came in. I don't want to call them thugs. I don't want to call anybody a thug. These were young, teen, maybe late teens, early 20s guys, not in uniform, who had come to destroy the apartment. So they went from room to room with axes and knives, and slashed all the chairs and, you know, used the axes on all the furniture, pushed over the china cabinet, all the china was in smithereens, and yelling, and they herded us out in the corridor. It was kind of a U-shaped corridor. We were all herded together, scared to death, and saying, again, threatening us the whole time they were doing this. And what I remember most is when I was 11 years old, I had an axe swung over my head. They were saying, you know, this is it, you know. And I thought, sure, my last hour had struck. I will never, believe me, I will never forget that moment. And of course, as you can see, we survived. I mean, I survived, and the rest of us did too. And I don't know how long the thing took. Maybe it took an hour, maybe more. I don't know. I don't even know, because we were so frozen in fear that we couldn't keep track of time. And they finally left, kind of with insults, "We'll be back." And we thought, you know, maybe they'll come back to finish the job, but that didn't happen. And eventually we found a couple, I still remember that, a couple of beds in the back room that they had overlooked, and I slept in one of them with my grandfather and my cousin, and my mother, aunt, and my aunt's mother slept in the other bed. And I remember when one of them had to go to the bathroom, they escorted her, you know, and later talking about it, they sort of laughed about it, because, you know, this, like, the hysteria that you find when you go to a funeral, sometimes people start laughing because of the tension. Well, it was like that. And then the next morning, they sent out my cousin and me, just 11, they figured they wouldn't hurt the kids, to see what had happened to the other Jews. So we went down the main street of Wittenberg, where some of the shops were, mostly haberdasheries. And they were all his windows were smashed, and big Stars of David painted on everything, Yuda, and looted, merchandise was looted. And then we actually had two people that came by. One was one of my friends from school, a guy that was, well, anyway, he had brought a few cups and saucers from his mother, just as a token gesture. And then another, a foreman from the factory came and brought some coffee, I remember that. And they expressed their sympathy, you know, this is terrible. But, you know, it didn't help anything, you know, it was just a gesture. And then finally, I was told that I should not come back to school. I'd been, you know, kicked out of school, no surprise there. And then we were told we had to move in and double up with another Jewish family, and we moved in with this other mother and son.
For clarity, how old were you at this time? Still 11?
I was 11, yeah, because I had turned 11 on August, this was November, so I was 11.
Okay.
Yeah. And for 3 months after that, we lived that way under virtual house arrest, because it was now not against the law to kill Jews. So if we were out in the street, any crazy could take a shot at us and kill us, no punishment. That's how far things had gone. Because Jews were essentially worthless. They were worse than, you know, they were just vermin. They were just the misfortune of the German people. In fact, they had a newspaper, the Stürmer, which was posted under my aunt's balcony, as a matter of fact, which like a hate sheet. And it showed, like, on the front page, it would show Jews with big noses, little dwarf-like figures, salivating after Christian virgins, you know, it was like, and it said, the Jews are our misfortune, and how long can we take this? It was constantly hate, hate, hate. And I can tell you, these days, I hear some echoes of that on the campaign trail. When I hear some of the hate mongering and the hate language and the demonizing of minorities, it just really puts a fear of God in me, because I know how that started in Germany and then how it ended. And I don't necessarily think it would end the same way, but just alone to be, and I know, I mean, for example, I know how African Americans feel. It's always like, well, will this white person treat me as an equal, or will he not? So it's always like, should I be obsequious, or should I be defiant? How should I present myself in order to not get hurt? I can really identify with that, because you don't have any choices, because you don't know when somebody will say, damn nigger, or something like that. And after, you are black. And so when they call you, so what are you gonna say? If you think the society is against you, then you feel really defenseless. You feel, and I really can tell you, I don't know, some of my black friends at first, they don't really trust that I can understand that. They say, well, you're white, how could you possibly understand that? But once they hear my story, they say, well, maybe you can. Because I've been through that. And still, you can see I'm tearing up just thinking about it. And how horrible I think that is. And how that has, when we came to America, I thought this was paradise. And now that I know a little bit more about racism in this country, it's not all that, you know? So.
I appreciate you sharing just that experience. I can only imagine how traumatic that must have been. And I'm curious to see what your impression was of your hometown after that took place.
Well,
like, how do you look at your community now?
Well, now it's different. But then, after that, I think people, a lot of people were ashamed. Because when we walked down the street, and my cousin and I walked down the street that time to the main street, people would look away. They couldn't face us because some of them probably were ashamed of what had happened. I know they were, because I mean, one woman, doctor's wife, actually communicated that. Mm-hmm. I'm so ashamed of, you know, what happened to you. But they were the, you know, what could they do?
So you're saying not everyone was in support of what was taking place?
No, I don't think so. Because there were some really, you know, Christian people that were, you know, church going, that were good people, like, you know. But when you're in a dictatorship where it's, if you speak up, you go with them. Essentially, that's what the message was. Oh, you want to be with the Jews? Fine, you can go with them. You know, when they get sent to the concentration camps. And it happened. Do you know, anybody hear of Pastor Niemöller? There was a pastor there, yes. Oh, how come you have all this special knowledge? Are you,
My mother's a survivor.
Oh, okay, I figured there was something there. So Pastor Niemöller famously said, first they came for the Jews, and I wasn't a Jew, so I didn't speak up. Then they came for the trade unionists, and I wasn't a trade unionist, so I didn't say anything. Then they came for the, what other groups there were, Catholics or homosexuals, and I wasn't one of those, so I didn't speak up. And when they came for me, there was no one left to speak for me. And that's what happens when you remain silent in the face of oppression, and, you know, that is so important. And I often mention that in my speeches when I give a talk. I say it's not enough to think right thoughts. You also have to speak up, and when you hear a racial slur, you have to say, hey, you know, that's not correct. Why are you saying that? You have to call people on that stuff. Otherwise they feel, you know, it's okay with him too. So a lot of people feel, well, I don't open my mouth because they might not like me. Well, you don't want to be liked by those people. I mean, that's really not worth catering to.
Can I ask a follow-up question? Richard, so after your dad was taken to the concentration camp, how many of you were left in your family?
You mean...
Is it just you and your mother?
Yes. Well, and then my aunt, and, you know, and my cousin, and my grandfather, also my father's father, and my aunt's mother. That was essentially it.
Could you describe how you moved on, or what took place after your father was taken?
Well, first of all, I always wondered, what did we live on? Because, you know, he wasn't going to work. In fact, the factory was essentially confiscated. You know, that was no longer a going concern. In fact, when my father, who eventually did come out of concentration camp after 3 months, and people say, how come he got out? And the reason was that I think my theory is that they wanted to get all the Jewish men out of the way of Kristallnacht so they wouldn't put up resistance. But then later, something called the Final Solution, when all the Jews were rounded up and sent to camps, and they mostly did not come back. I mean, a few survived, but I mean, mostly that was it. But this first round was, I think it was just to prevent resistance. So when he got out, and we finally...
When you say he got out, you mean your father?
Out of concentration camp, yes. When he got out of concentration camp, I was already out of the country. When I left Germany on a child rescue operation called the Kinder Transport, because we had relatives in London, I had an aunt and uncle in London, and my cousin and I got on that. The only way you could get on it is if you had a parent in concentration camp, or you had someone in England to take you in, and we had both. And my mother and my aunt brought us to Berlin to the boat train. I remember that vividly too. I remember sitting in the train going out of Wittenberg and looking out the window and seeing the roofs of the town disappearing behind me and thinking, I will never see this place again. Everything that I valued was left behind, you know. Everything I'd had, my friends, my school, my relatives, my home, I mean, for a small child, for a young child, that's everything. That's the whole world. What were they going into? Into an unknown future. And we got off in Berlin, and my aunt and my mother took us to where the boat train was going off, and they were not even allowed to come on the train, put us on the train. And when I said goodbye to my mother, it's another moment that's hard to talk about. And I saw the tears running down her cheeks. And I thought that I might never see my parents again, which most of the Kinder Transports kids did not. Most of them never saw their parents again. I was one of the lucky ones. And it was a terrible moment. I didn't know if my father was going to be alive, you know? And my mother was just, and so she sort of waved to me from a distance. And we got on the train and we were out of there. And of course, we did get to England, and we took the boat train into London, and I thought my aunt and uncle would come and meet us, and they did at Victoria Station. And, you know, they embraced us, and my aunt said, "You're safe now." And as I say in the book, and I tried to believe her. I tried to believe her. Because it's not that easy after that experience to really feel safe again. And as a matter of fact, if I can jump ahead, same thing happened when we arrived in New York Harbor. We caught the last, as far as I know, the last passenger ship out of Europe before the war started, because war started, well, maybe I should stay in sequence, but...
Yeah, that'd probably be preferred. We'll get to it, I promise. We'll get there.
All right, fine. But you may not know the right questions to ask.
I am curious. So your father was arrested, was taken to a concentration camp, and then he was released. How did he get out?
Well, as I say, they were released gradually, the men that were rounded up around Kristallnacht. Okay. They were gradually released again because that resistance was no longer relevant.
So did you end up seeing your parents again after moving away?
Well, yes, in England.
Can you describe that experience and what...
Well, I got to England and not knowing, you know, what would happen to my parents, and I thought I might never see them again. And then one night the phone rang. And we answered. That was my father. Wow. That was a moment too, you know. He had been released. And I was like, oh. I mean, you could just imagine not knowing if he would be killed or not. And there he was. And you know, we spoke briefly, you know, and then they were still in Germany, and my father had to try to sell off the machinery from the factory, and finally the factory itself was virtually taken over. I mean, it was like everybody knew it was a distressed sale because there was no choice. I mean, it had to be sold. And my parents, with the money from all that stuff, bought a crate full of furniture for immigration to America eventually, so we'd have some furniture. They even bought a sewing machine because they figured my mother would have to make all our clothes and all that. And this big crate was put in the international port of Hamburg, supposed to be international territory. But when the time came that we moved to America, the Nazis had confiscated it anyway, so we never saw all that furniture or anything again. So, yeah.
So you describe when you saw your father again. What was that like when you saw your father and mother again for the first
time? Well, first of all, if you saw his, in the book I have a picture of his identity card. We all had to have identity cards. I had to have one with a big letter J on it. And all the Jewish men had to have a middle name, Israel. So I'm Richard Israel Wiener, I was. And the women were called Sarah, so my mother's name was Mary Sarah Wiener, for easy identification. You know, it's like, and then later, of course, they've had the yellow star, but we were out of Germany by that time. That was a couple of years later. In other words, everyone should know who's a Jew and who isn't, you know? And if you took off your star, that was a crime. You could immediately be sent to concentration camp for that. because they didn't want any Jews to escape safely. So in England, the war broke out, and my school, I went to an ordinary public school in England. We were evacuated out of London because they were going to be bombing London. So I lived with an English family, a foster family, for a year. I didn't see my parents the entire year. And what I remember about that is we arrived in this little town called Hemel Hempstead. The teacher took us up the street, and all the people that had signed up for boarders, like kids that they would take in, I mean, they got paid for this. We walked up the street, and we came to a house where they had asked for, I don't know, two boys or three boys. And when the woman found out that we were German refugees, she said, "Not little Jewish German refugees, oh no." It was like, you know, I'm in England, and it's like, so we went up to the next house, and there was a very benevolent woman, and they had asked for two girls, an elderly couple. And when they heard about this, they, you know, took us in. They were very devout, you know, Wesleyans, which is, Wesleyan is a form of Methodist, is it? Yeah. And she said, "Come on," and she gave us a cup of tea and set us down. And I felt like, you know, somebody still, you know, who can be loving, and I felt so relieved. And we lived that couple for a whole year, and they treated us like their own children. It was a very small house. The three boys shared one bedroom, and there was only one other bedroom. And in the living room, there was a fireplace, and only if you got there early, you got to sit in one of the two chairs. And usually, the house was damp, as it is in England. And it was good. I joined a little group called Ralph Richardson and his Harmonica Boys. We used to entertain the evacuees. And we had our little victory garden. You know, we planted some carrots and...
So you play the harmonica?
Just this one, this kind.
Oh, okay. We'd love to see that maybe later on in the evening.
Not well. And I was their vocalist, actually. I was the boy soprano. Anyway, so those were some of the less difficult times. And then we got on the ship, and the sister ship had already been sunk.
When you say we, who's we?
My parents and I.
Okay, so before you jump to that part, can you talk a little bit about the reunion with you and your parents? Specifically, like what that was like when you saw them for the first time after being separated for so long?
Well, it was lots of tears and hugging and, you know, and so on. And my father was not much of a hugger, by the way. he was a silent generation guy, you know, but he was good to see, you know, he was like, you know, very formal, stiff German, you know, you probably know that type, right? Yeah, but it was, and then it wasn't much longer after that, because they came over, it was already like June of 1939, the war broke out the 1st of September, so it wasn't long. We were evacuated then, and I didn't see them for another year. We finally, my father had applied for visas. He had gone to Palestine in the 30s, and he liked it, and that's what he wanted to emigrate to. My mother had been to America to see her divorced father, and she wanted to go to America. So my father applied for visas to both countries, and we figured we'd go wherever one came through first. It took 4 years, because America was not opening its doors. They had a tiny little quota. FDR was criticized for that, and he said it was politically not possible because it was the end of the Great Depression, people unemployed, and you couldn't take in 400,000 Jewish refugees, it would be politically a disaster. So therefore, you had these famous things like the St. Louis, where the ship that was couldn't dock, and it was terrible, and meanwhile, people being murdered in Europe, and yet many of them had no place to go. They would tend to go to places like Bolivia, that's where my aunt and uncle went, or Shanghai was a place, or Dominican Republic was a place. Some of the countries that could use, you know, people were educated and had a business sense, they would take them in, you know. But so we finally arrived in New York Harbor. That's another moment I will never, ever forget. because we had been traveling under blackout because of the U-boat campaign, and life preservers carried all day with us. And finally, after 10 days, we arrived in New York Harbor, and everybody was on deck. And when the Statue of Liberty came into view, tears, prayers, some people went at their knees. I'll never forget that. It's like, free at last, oh Lord, I'm free at last. Unforgettable. And so, unless you've been through that, you may think you appreciate your country. But you gotta have been there to really appreciate what you have here. It's not perfect. Definitely not perfect, but compared to the horrible scenes in Germany and other countries, you know, that this country's pretty damn good. And I'm pretty lucky to be here. Hundreds of millions of people wish that they were here. And so you guys can see, you know, the Syrian refugees and all these people that's desperate to come here. And then, of course, you have people that say, what? Immigrants? We don't want any immigrants. Who knows? There might be terrorists and all this stuff. And it's so easy to say that, you know. But, and of course, people have, what do you call that? Compassion fatigue. You know, when you, there's so many people that need help that eventually you feel, well, I can only help so many, you know, and you just feel, what more can I do? I can't possibly save everyone in the world. And so now we're in America.
So I want to, for the sake of time, I want to talk a little bit about your return.
Fast forward. Yes.
To Wittenberg. All right, I want to know a little bit more about how that came about and what was your motivation for even going back to this town that you had left so long ago?
Good question. Actually, that is really how my story differs from some other refugee stories. Because there are millions of terrible stories of victims of Nazism, and mine is not the only one, but there are less people. That the time came when the Berlin Wall came down, and it was for the first time. My hometown was in East Germany, so for the first time it was possible to really go back and visit. I think you could have gone on a day trip out of Berlin before that, but I never did that. So why did I go back? Why do you long for your hometown, where you grew up, the roots, the places you know, the stream that went down, you know, or the river you swam in at home, the language that you spoke, the songs you sang, and you know, I had a great need for closure. I had lost all that, and here was a chance to at least see it again. Mm-hmm. Now, I had been to West Germany on business, but not to East Germany, where Wittenberg is located. And so I decided, despite all the fears of what I would find there, because I had left it, you know, my life is in danger, and we had to leave, kind of, you know. We couldn't stay. And how would it be now? Would there still be anti-Semitism? Or how would people feel now? Would they feel guilty about seeing me again? But my need for closure and my longing to see my hometown again was so strong that I took the risk, and I took my son with me. He was then a college senior, so he went with me. And we went to Berlin. We stayed in Berlin a few days, and you know, we had a nice time there. I showed him around a little bit. And then we had arranged with my best childhood friend Wolfgang to meet us in Berlin at a hotel in East Berlin. And we took a cab to East Berlin. I remember we went to, it was called a Showplace Hotel. I mean, they built a few, East Berlin was essentially in ruins, but they had built a few, you know, show places to impress people. And we walked, rode up on the escalator to the first floor where the lobby was, and I thought, would I even recognize Wolfgang again after 51 years? 51 years I'd been away. Because I was then already 1989, how old was it? 62, I guess. 62. And then I saw two men at the far end of the lobby, and our eyes met. And it was, you know, how that is sometimes you can, a little meeting of the eyes, and you kind of get it. And we started slowly walking toward each other, and then running, and then we were just the longest hug I ever experienced in my life. It was like an epiphany, you know, all that had happened, all those years in between, all the murder of millions of people and the leveling of cities and all that was like disappeared for the moment. And we just got in a little German car, the Wartburg, was a little German junky car, and we all squeezed in. The other guy was his daughter's boyfriend, actually, who had driven him, and drove toward Wittenberg. And when I saw the church towers, there are two very big churches there, in the distance, my heart started pounding. Now, this is where it had all happened. This was like the lion's den from which we had escaped. And what would I find? We drove into town, and it looked exactly as I had left it, as I remembered it. Because it's a medieval town that had not been bombed. And we drove around the old medieval marketplace and the cobblestones where the farmers used to come, you know, every twice a week with their produce. And everything was like yesterday. You know, it was like a time capsule. Then we drove down and turned into Luther Street, which was my town, my street, Luther Street, Lutherstraße. And we stopped in front of 22A. And I went crazy. I said, Michael, that was my house. And that was my room, the first floor. And the curtains parted in my old childhood room, and a little girl looked out at us. And we went. And in the backyard, there were a bunch of old people sitting on a bench. And as we approached, this old woman, she must have been like almost as old as I am now, jeez. In those days, I thought she was
some
old.
Some individuals want to know, how old are you?
I'm 89 years old. And so this old woman gets up.
By the way, probably one of the most energetic 89-year-olds I've ever met in my life. He works out and runs and brings him. Yeah.
Actually, I'm a toreador in my spare time. No. So this Owen comes toward me with open arms and says, "Das kleine Richardchen, little Richard." She remembered me when I was 11 years old. And she had baked a cake, and we went upstairs to her apartment. She had champagne, and we toasted my return. And then I was going to leave without seeing my childhood, our childhood apartment. And Michael, my son, said, "Dad, you came all this way. How can you not want to see your childhood apartment?" And I said, "Well, I don't want to disturb the people." Well, it happened that a person came down the street that was a student of my friend Wolfgang's, and she knew those people. So we got in, and I actually got into my childhood room that I had left when I was 11 years old. And it looked pretty much the same. The same stucco in the ceiling, and the only thing that changed, they had modernized the kitchen and the bathroom, which used to be very primitive in the old days. And then we went over to the gymnasium, which had been under communist. I mean, see, Germany had been, East Germany had been under communist occupation for 45 years. So everything was communist now. First was Nazi, now it's communist. All these people had lived under communist rule. I mean, there was the Russian zone, essentially. And they had the gym where we used to work out was completely, all the apparatus was gone. The textbooks were all communist textbooks. But we met with the principal, the first woman principal was, and she greeted us cordially. And then they finally had actually an exhibition about the history of the Wittenberg Jews, including a little plaque about me. And it was really something. And then we were received by the mayor in the Renaissance Town Hall. And that mayor just recently retired. I knew him for 25 years, from that time on. And then, well, I'll fast forward a couple of years. I've been going back every year or two. I've been back, the last year was my 13th time that I went back since the fall of the Berlin Wall, because I love it so much. And I'm now like a rock star when I go to Virginia. I really am. I always go to school and I talk to the students. Everybody wants to talk to me. I'm always interviewed by the press. I always have a story on the front page of the Central German paper, because I'm well known for my work on reconciliation. So this is what happened. About the third or fourth time, there was a class reunion. So this is the first time I would be meeting back with my classmates that had, you know, been so nasty to some of them. And we met in the nicest restaurant in town, overlooking the marketplace. And I suggested to the MC, who was really the arrogant, formerly arrogant son of the department store owner of the town, and I suggested that why don't we all have a chance to share a little bit about our lives, because I wanted to. And when I got up and I told them about how it was for me during recess in the schoolyard, the room got very silent. And I saw some tears in a few men's eyes. They were there with their wives mostly. They were, you know, also around 70 by then, as I was around 70. And it was like the weight of the past was heavily upon them. And at the end of the evening, we're putting on our coats, and this guy, Horst, comes over to me, and he's very embarrassed. And he says, "Richard, I have to tell you something." And he just could hardly get the words out. "I was one of the ringleaders, and I want to ask for your forgiveness." And those were the words I'd waited for all my life. And when they came, we both started to cry, and we embraced, and it was like, whew, it was all that stuff was gone. And it was like, I was liberated. It was like a weight came off me, and probably off him too. And that was the beginning of my journey of forgiveness. And it got stronger when I found out what the Nazis had done to the non-Jewish Germans. I mean, that had bought into all, that had drunk the Kool-Aid of Nazism. And then when the war ended, they saw that the country's in absolute ruins. All the major cities were leveled to the ground. What was it, 10 million young men, I believe, were killed in the war? So it was not, you know, there were lots of widows. And it's almost, they always say the widows were the ones that almost rebuilt Germany, that got rid of all the trash in the streets and all the rubble. And it was like they had to start from scratch. And it took many years. I used to send care packages to Europe with food because they were in dire straits. And I began to feel compassion for those whom I had regarded as my persecutors. And that was a surprise. That was the beginning of my understanding of what reconciliation and forgiveness is all about.
Can I ask, what did that do for those that you forgave?
It liberated both of us.
Really?
They always say that the Germans need Jews to forgive them, and the Jews need Germans to accept them. So it's like a win-win. You know, in other words, in fact, I belong to an organization where we do trainings, and we did a couple of trainings in Germany, and the trainees were Germans who had no idea of my history. At the end of the training, I spoke to them and I told them my story, and I said, "I want you to forgive your fathers and grandfathers for what they did back then. And I want you to let go of the burden of guilt that you've been carrying all these years, because I don't blame the offsprings for the sins of their fathers." You know, it was like, and it was like, you could almost hear them, you know, let out the breath, because that's what they needed to hear from a Jew. And it was, you know, these are just, I've accumulated so many beautiful moments like that of compassion and not setting people free in a way of their past, as I have set myself free from my past. I have moved on. And so many, when I hear fellow refugees say, I would never set foot in that country, and how could you, I bought a Beetle, my first car was a Beetle, how could you buy a German car after all they did to you? I said, well, what, do you want them to have another depression, where they'll have another, you know? So it was like, you have to think outside the box, you know? You have to be able to forgive. I mean, look what happened in South Africa. You remember that when they had apartheid ended? Mm-hmm. They had the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, or they would have had a civil war. And the oppressed blacks and coloreds of South Africa reconciled with the former apartheid regime on the condition that they open up and talk about what they did. In other words, there was a price to pay, but then they took them in, even into the government. And it was a beautiful thing, you know? And you see examples of that all over the world. Like I think in Rwanda, places mm-hmm. like that. And that's the hope of the future. How else will we ever have world peace if we keep avenging the past generations, you know?
So Richard, your platform is forgiveness and reconciliation, which by the way, I just applaud your courage for going back to this place that left some pretty harsh memories. And actually forgiving those that had oppressed your family and you. And so I thank you for even sharing that piece.
Yeah.
I want to say that a lot of times I talk to individuals about forgiveness because it's part of a leadership platform that I think we don't talk enough about. You know, in order to really truly heal and be an effective leader, that process of forgiveness needs to take place. And I often hear this phrase, which I'm sure a lot of people in the room have heard as well, but in order to forgive, you need to forget.
No, No. Absolutely not.
I want to hear your take on that. No, because I've heard it so much.
Often I've had this where I'd be talking to an audience, and there'd be somebody in the audience who has actually been in a concentration camp. How could you, you know, you're telling these kids to forgive, next you'll tell them to forget. I said, oh no, I will never forget. I mean, the scars will always remain, but the wounds have healed. Two different things, you know? And forgetting is, we must remember. You know, and I think I always say, those who forget history are doomed to repeat it. You've heard that.
Yes.
You've got to remember in order to see the warning signs, like I see with the man whose name I don't want to mention, you know, but you know who I'm talking about.
You mean in this current election? Is that what you're referring to?
Okay. It's not CD. It's.
I think we're getting going.
It's DT, right?
So I want to ask, how has that experience affected your life?
It has. I want to say something about leadership. Is that okay?
Sure.
I know you're not interested in that subject, but.
Yeah, no, of course not. No. That's all we talk about.
So, what's the connection between my life experience and leadership, right? And I always talk about, we all, maybe you've heard this before, we all have two wolves inside of us, a dark wolf and a light wolf. And how we live depends on which wolf we feed. Now, when you have a government that is like Trumpian kind of trouble, it speaks to our worst instincts. We all have worst instincts, but most of us learn to keep them inside and to go to the bright side, not to the dark side. But when you have somebody who's a rabble-rouser, who can, you know, incite people, say, you know, and find a scapegoat, now it's the Muslims today, then it was the Jews, now it's the Muslims and whoever else, then it takes character and fortitude and patience and so forth, not to go with the flow. If all around you are going, you know, jumping over like lemmings into the abyss. And I talk about leadership. I'm just going to say a word about leadership. What's a leader? What defines a leader? There are inspirational leaders. There are violent leaders. There are dictators. There are all kinds of leaders, good, bad, and indifferent. Tyrants, despots, but what do they all have in common? They all have in common that they inspire send people to follow them. And so did Hitler and Stalin and, you know, all these people. And so did Martin Luther King. And, you know, and John Kennedy and so forth. They were leaders. But doesn't mean you're a good person because you're a leader. They're good leaders, and then there are poisonous leaders. And we're seeing too many of those when you see some of the rhetoric, even not just Trump himself, but a lot of the people that are in his supporters. So to me, in what way am I a leader? I mean, I'm not a leader in the ordinary sense of like, you know, that kind of a leader. But because of my conviction about forgiveness and reconciliation, a lot of people listen to me and interview me and support me. And in that sense, I'm a leader. So I'm hopefully a leader for good, for helping people to become better, to heal them of some of their childhood wounds, because we all have them. And my favorite aphorism is, sweet are the uses of adversity. I always repeat that. In fact, I was going to start with that, but I certainly want to mention it. The first keynote address I ever gave was called The Uses of Adversity. And what I mean by that is that we've all had adversity in our lives, be it, could be abusive parents, it could be a serious illness, could be alcoholism or drugs or whatever. Nobody gets through without some adversity. Some are worse than others. Some come early in life, some come later in life. And in fact, one of the things that inspired me to become such friends with Everett is he told me some of the adversity in his early life, and it spoke to me. It kind of, I could identify. You know, I said, here's somebody who's transcended the difficulties of his childhood. And I feel that I have more or less done that. And when you do that, you can become pretty powerful. People say, well, gee, if he can do that, who am I to say I can't do mine? You know, I get that all the time. Well, if he can get over what happened to him in Nazi Germany, how can I complain because, you know, whatever lesser thing happened to me? And so we have the power to inspire when we transcend our, and I think every single person in the room potentially has that power. You have to believe it. You have to own what happened to you. You have to be very clear about it and be willing to share it. Say, look, this is what happened to me, but that was the past, and now is now. That was then, and now is now. It's like the Cubs, you know. So I feel I feel grateful, I feel fortunate, I feel like I've had a great life, and there's lots more to my life than I've told tonight, in between those, Germany and here, my life has been very exciting and fulfilling. I've talked to lots of people, before lots of audiences, and it's such a privilege to be able to see that you make a difference. And we all have that in one way or the other, the ability to make a difference in other people's lives. If we care enough, you gotta care enough. You gotta say, I want, you know, I used to hear this from my fellow Jews, when something happened, is it good for the Jews? Or in this country, USA number one, is it good for America? And I said, no. I said, if it's good for the world, it's good for the Jews, and it's good for America. If it isn't good for everyone, unless everyone is free, unless everyone is not persecuted, I can't feel completely free either. Because you never know when things will flip, you know? So I want everyone to have their needs met. And that's a tall order. It's not going to happen in the foreseeable future. But at least let's go in that direction. Let's have more and more freedom and more equality and acceptance and unity, right? That's the word, unity. Yes. The word I heard on Sunday at the service. Why can't we all get along, as, you know, a famous saying. And I have a dream, like Martin Luther King did, that one day I won't be around. Some of you young folks may be, but one day that'll come to pass. and you know.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Richard. What I would like to do now, I have one final question that I'll save to the very end, is I'd like to give the audience a chance to ask a few questions. Obviously, we're a little limited on time here, but Richard will be here after the event is over. So if you'd like to approach him and ask him some direct questions one-on-one. Richard loves to talk. That's one thing I've learned.
How dare you?
You know it's true. You know it's very true. And he is so open to sharing his experiences with individuals. And that's what I love about him and even his willingness to come here today. So I just wanted to open it up to the audience to see if anyone had a specific question that they would like to ask Richard while he's here.
And I got to tell you, when I was speaking at a school and it came time for Q&A, and a young girl said, what color eyes did Hitler have? that was her question.
That's an interesting
so I hope
question.
Your questions are a little more, you know, relevant.
So does anyone here have a question that they'd like to ask?
Jessica? So earlier, Mr. Gutierrez mentioned that you were energetic, sore out.
Sort of, you know.
So would you say that because of your experience that you have a greater appreciation of life? That's one question. And then two is, the older woman you mentioned when you visited your hometown, who was she? Was she a German neighbor?
She was a neighbor in the house, and she remembered my mother. She asked after my mother.
Yeah. Was she someone that you had to forgive, or was she just indifferent?
She was what?
Was she someone you had to forgive?
No. She was just a housewife in one of the apartments.
And how about her first question with appreciation for life, as you are very spirited and young still at heart? And
well, I have this thing about, I have about 20 mentees, actually, back in Washington. And most of them, of course, are young, but they go all the way up to early 80s, from 30s to early 80s. Very few are as young as this whippersnapper here, but I always tell them, and I told you that, I think, yesterday, about balancing your acceptance of your mortality and the limitations of life, that we only have so much time, and also living life to the full. And don't get hung up in, oh my God, life is short, and going into playing small. Play as big as you can while you're here. That's my feeling about it.
That's great advice. Thank you.
Thank you.
Richard, Greg.
You certainly, as a young person, went through tremendous bullying, discrimination, really bad experiences. Some transitioned from that really dark place to where you are today. Can you talk a little bit about how that transition came about? Are there some observations or revelations that you went through that might be relevant to some of us?
Well, as a matter of fact, as you were speaking, a little scene came to mind that happened in Brooklyn, where we landed in Brooklyn. I was preparing for my bar mitzvah, which is like confirmation, and I had to go a certain street to the synagogue where the training was taking place. I used to pass the house of a red-headed guy who was maybe 16 or 17, and every time I passed, he would yell, "You dirty kike," you know, "You dirty kike." And I was like sucking it up, you know, it was like I was, you know, stuffing it, because what could I do with this big guy? And then one day in the winter, he was shoveling snow, and as I went by, he put a shovel of snow on my shoes and said, "You dirty cat, take this." And I lost it, and I jumped him, and I wrestled him to the ground, and I bloodied his nose, and it was like all the accumulated bottling up suddenly exploded at that moment, and he never bothered me again. It's funny. Yes?
Yes.
My name is Robert. I was inspired by his story.
Thank you.
I have two questions. The first question is, what are the simple things in life that makes you happy? And the second question is, how do you attract leaders?
How do I?
Attract leaders.
Attract leaders? Mm-hmm. Simple things in life? I love it. I had a wonderful education at Columbia University, which was actually Pedro for Uncle Sam, otherwise it wouldn't have happened. And so I love music, I love art, I've taken acting classes, I'm in a yoga class, I take piano lessons even now. I do Lumosity games. I have 20 mentees, as I say. I belong to an international brotherhood called the Mankind Project. We do transformational weekend trainings on all over the world. I belong to a book club, etc. That was how do I, does that answer the first question?
How do you attract leaders?
How do I attract leaders? Well, it's not, I don't know whether I attract leaders, but that I have sort of radar that tells me when somebody has leader potential. And then in other words, with my mentees, I lead them to their gold. I let them see their gold, which they may never have realized. I say, do you realize that you have this power or this ability, and that you there's much more to you than you think? Really? You know, I mean, you know how, especially young people, they don't really know all that they have to offer. And when an older man says that, you know, then, gee, I guess, you know, with all his life experience, I guess he sees something, that there must be something there, you know. And that's sort of what happens. And then I will encourage them to take the next step, to maybe apply for that job that they didn't think they're qualified for, or to, you know, to consider other options in their lives, basically. So, something like that. Yeah, is that answered?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. All right. Yeah.
Brian.
Earlier you mentioned, answering his question, how you had that pent up emotion, you jumped that kid, you know, you beat him up and things like that. So I think that tells a lot about all that oppressed emotions and feelings you had when you're growing up, and obviously right now you're much more open about how you feel about different things. How did you kind of go from this oppressed child to a relatively open person? And at the same time, when you're growing up with that, all the oppression, I feel like you could have really gone the other way, really hate the world, hate everybody, all that.
Okay, I'll tell you what I did. I'll tell you what I did. First of all, of course, the climate was different. I mean, when I was in America, I wasn't subjected to the same kind of abuse. But I also, until I had a lot of psychoanalysis when I came to Washington, many years of psychoanalysis, which got me off the floor, partially. But I also, for many years, I was a lone wolf. I vagabonded around the country by myself. I worked hard labor jobs out west and on the railroad and with the Mexican fruit pickers and all kinds of stuff alone, because I could only trust myself. I couldn't fully trust anyone else. It took me a long time to be able to trust people again. And I have a lot of assurance that they really meant it, you know, that they weren't just, you know, blowing smoke. It took me many years, and I got married. I didn't get married until I was 39 years old. Now I have a couple of kids and grandkids, but I was a late bloomer in that sense. It was like I always said, he travels fastest who travels alone, but they always say, if you want to travel fast, travel alone. If you want to travel far, travel with others. Mm-hmm. And I finally learned that. It's good. You know?
It's
a
very
good
one,
isn't it? Yeah.
With the way the world is now, I want to know, like, your views on the African American community, like with the Black Lives Matters and the protests and everything. What are your views on that, and how do you feel as if, like, everything around us can actually change, for everybody could actually come together?
Well, I tell you, in Germany, the Jews didn't have the power to say, well, they tried a little an uprising in the Warsaw Ghetto, but it was doomed to defeat because they were too weak. But now that African Americans are really conscious of, it's now becoming not just anecdotes that somebody got shot here, somebody got shot there, but now it's like, it's a pattern, we see the pattern, and Latinos are sort of allying a little bit with African Americans. I think it's a turning point. I think it's really a turning point in America, and long overdue.
What do you think us as a community, you know, with everybody that's not gangbanging and actually doing the violence and everything like that, what do you think that we can do to actually stop everything from going on?
I think peaceful, as much as possible, peaceful. Well, like Martin Luther King did, you know. Don't go to violence, because that'll be used against you. Say, you see, they're just a bunch of hoodlums, right? But when you march peacefully, you don't even have to say a word. You just march and you're seen. Or like, you know, all these, at the time of the Black Power, I remember Black Power movement. There was a lot of violence in Washington. They burned down a lot of properties, you know? And that allows the bigots then to say, you see, we have to protect ourselves against them. Whereas if you are nonviolent, it may take longer, but eventually you win over the public to say, yeah, you know, they're not doing anything by you. Why are they being treated this way? And you get more allies that way, I think. Is that answered?
Yes. Yeah, there's actually a protest going on Michigan Street right now.
Okay.
So that's why I asked you the question.
Yeah, because I think they call it provocateurs that try to get the march to be violent so they have an excuse to beat them down.
Right.
Like they did with the Native Americans out west, in where they were trying to lie the pipeline through their ancestral burial grounds, and they came from all over the country, and I think they won. I think they had to back down from that because they all came together in silent protests, but they were still throwing mace at them and tear gas and dogs and all that, just like they did in Selma, you know. So you got to be patient, but in the long run, the curve of justice, what did Obama say? The curve of justice, curve bends toward justice, but you gotta be patient. It takes time, yeah.
So Richard, I'm gonna use this time to ask my final question and then allow you to engage after the event with others that want to ask more follow-ups. So as you know, we have individuals in the room who know a little bit about Legacy Leaders. We even have some individuals online who are watching live, who have also heard about Legacy Leaders, are hearing about it for the first time.
Yes.
So we know that you're an avid supporter of our work, and that's actually part of why you're here today, and also in addition to the relationship that we've built over the years. So I'm just curious, what would you say to the individuals listening in the room about whether or not they should get involved with organizations like ours, and what motivation behind that they should listen to as they think about, you know, whether or not I should do this. Should I get in? Should I come off the fence?
Are you talking about people who are already leaders in some other way, or
yeah, the people in the room who are hearing about Legacy Leaders, even those online? What would you say to them if they're thinking about
it? I would say, all right, I would ask the question: what kind of a life do you want to live? Do you want to live a life of just simply making it, going to work, making a living, you know, going home, making love, going to bed, going to work, and go take a vacation, and you know, is that the kind of life you want to live? Then Legacy Leaders is not for you. But if you want to live a full life where you're making a difference, where you are helping young people to make something of themselves, where you're inspiring people, that's where the thrill in life is, you know? It's not in just being safe. If you just want to be safe and make sure that, you know, a lot of people stay in jobs they hate because, you know, I don't want to take a chance taking any risks. If you take no risk and do something a little more audacious, then you're going to have a boring life, and one day you lie on your deathbed and say, what did I do with my life? You know, you only have one life. Make it mean something. And I know that Legacy Leaders is not the only possible, only game in town, but it's a good one, and you've got people who are already energizing it and that can use more support to make it bigger and more widespread and help more people. And I think, you know, what better way to spend your energy? Does that answer your question?
Yes.
So,
thank you. Thank you very much. Can we give Richard a round of applause? Our board mentor.